Good evening, everyone, and welcome to History, Mystery, and Murder. This is episode number one, and it's the mysterious death of William Garrett Howard. My name is Linda Paris, and these are my stories from the Southampton Press that I researched and wrote myself for a series entitled History, Mystery, and Murder. This one is called The Mysterious Death of William Garrett Howard. It took place in 1915 in Sag Harbor, and I hope you enjoy it. William Garrett Howard was a local photographer who by 1915 had been living in Sag Harbor for 34 years. Howard lived with his daughter Florence and was sometimes visited by his wife Anna, who no longer lived in the village. Florence Nelson, William Howard's daughter, is by far the most fascinating character in the curious sequence of events that ended in her father's death. 30-year-old Florence had been living with her father since the death of her second husband, William F. Holtz. Indeed, Florence was twice widowed, and both her first and her second husbands had died under very suspicious circumstances. This fact created a swirl of gossip around Florence amongst the villagers of Sag Harbor. She was described as, quote, a tall woman of erect carriage, and she was often referred to as, quote, robust, end quote. Florence was active in the church and had several intimate friends amongst the women of the village. Some people refer to Florence as a man-hater. James B. Nelson, a large, industrious man with an athletic build. That was Florence's first husband. It was approximately 7 months after their marriage that James Nelson was stricken with severe stomach pains that became progressively worse. He died 9 months after marrying Florence. 3 years later, Florence married William Holtz. Only 58 days after marrying Florence, Holtz was dead. He inexplicably began to experience violent stomach pains before suddenly passing away. Enter one Isabel Quackenbush. Isabel was a resident of Sag Harbor and a widow as well. According to reports, Quackenbush spent virtually all of her time in the Howard home with Florence. She would become a permanent fixture in Florence's life, and the air of mystery that surrounded their relationship in 1915 would continue for years. There is no information available on Isabel Quackenbush, her first marriage, or the manner in which her husband died. But suffice it to say, the two widows virtually ran the Howard household. In April of 1915, William Garrett Howard joined the ranks of Florence's previous husbands. He too developed violent stomach cramps, and his condition deteriorated quickly. He was taken to what was called, quote, the Southampton Sanitarium, end quote, otherwise known as the hospital. It was at this time that one of Howard's attending physicians received a mysterious anonymous letter. The letter was written in pencil and the writing described as a, quote, feminine hand, end quote. It was well composed and it was sent from out of state and signed with the initial M. In part, the letter stated, quote, I had information yesterday that compelled me to write you. If you want to cure him or save him a slow death, then you better have him taken away from home immediately. If necessary, show him this. Do anything to save his life. This is no idle gossip or talk. That is all I can say, end quote. Alarmed, to say the least, the doctor immediately sent the letter to the district attorney, Ralph C. Green, who acted promptly. You see, D.A. Green had already been warned of the situation in the Howard home by yet another person. It was William Howard's own father and Florence's grandfather, Garrett Howard Sr. of Greenport. It seems Howard Sr. had made the request that should his son die, an autopsy be performed immediately. While in the hospital, William Howard thrived. His stomach troubles went away and he rapidly regained his strength. He was sent home with a recommendation to retain a private nurse. D.A. Green, by all accounts, a thoughtful and noble prosecutor, took some extraordinary measures. After learning that William Howard was looking for an attendant upon his release from the hospital, D.A. Green hired a Brooklyn nurse to masquerade as Miss Mattie Clark. Unknown to any of the family members, she was placed in the home to watch over Mr. Howard and to take note of any suspicious activity that she saw. As soon as William Howard arrived home, his stomach troubles returned with a vengeance, and it was on June 7, 1915, that William Garrett Howard passed away. Undercover nurse Mattie Clark had much to tell D.A. Green. Green refused to reveal what was in her report. However, after his meeting with Mattie, the newspapers reported that the death of William Garrett Howard was now being investigated as a poisoning. There was much attention, however, paid in the press to an empty box of, quote, rough on rats, a popular turn-of-the-century rat poison found in the house. Interestingly, rough on rats pops up in many news stories between the years of 1800 and 1920. It was almost entirely composed of arsenic and was a popular product for those with both suicide and murder on their mind. The fact that death seemed to follow Florence Howard was well known amongst the villagers of Sag Harbor. The fact that Isabel Quackenbush seemed to have the same problem did not escape anyone's attention. That they were both in the house when William Howard passed away was a fact that caused a storm of activity amongst the people of Sag Harbor. Perhaps if they had known that there was someone else close to Florence who had met an untimely death, she might have been run out of town. At one time, Florence had a sibling. Although the cause of death is not known, and it is not even known if that child was male or female, it is of interest that yet another person living with Florence had died before their time. The investigation ended on a flat note. District Attorney Green could find no financial motive for the murder. William Howard was not a wealthy man, and Florence did not benefit financially from the death of either of her husbands. It was suggested that there was a motive contained in the report that Mattie Clark submitted to him. However, it was not enough for Green to press charges. The medical examiner did not find arsenic in William Howard's stomach. He tested for 26 other poisons as well, and all tests were negative. Two ads for Rough on Rats poison and a can from the early 1900s, an empty container, was found in the Howard home. Since there are virtually hundreds of poisons in existence, it could be argued that the medical report only proves that the Rough on Rats was not the cause of William Howard's death. It is certainly possible, though, that all three men were poisoned by a substance that was not detectable in 1915. According to the newspaper, Florence left town after the investigation and moved to Bridgeport, Connecticut with her mother. That might have been the story that Anna and Florence told the people of Sag Harbor. But upon further investigation, it seems that 5 years after the death of her father, she was calling herself Florence Holtz and living in Brooklyn with none other than Isabel Quackenbush and her two teenage sons. Their relationship is described as partners on the 1920 census. The 1930 census report shows the women still living together 10 years later. However, some curious changes have taken place in the 10 years that have passed. The two women are now described as sisters, and Mrs. Quackenbush has a new name, Nishwip. Mr. Nishwip is conspicuously absent from the report, and Isabel's marital status is again listed as, quote, widowed. This story leaves many unanswered questions in its wake. Who wrote the mysterious letter, and what did they know that compelled them to do so? Why did Garrett Howard Sr. suspect his own granddaughter of poisoning his son? What was in the report that Mattie Clark submitted to the D.A. Green? Did Florence Howard get away with murder? Did she meet Isabel Quackenbush, a partner in crime? The last two questions can only be answered by two people, and they have taken their secrets with them to their graves. So I hope you enjoyed this episode of History, Mystery, and Murder, The Mysterious Death of William Garrett Howard. I'm hoping to get a chance one rainy afternoon to sit down at my computer and see if I can dig up anything more on these fascinating women who could have potentially been a couple of serial killers. So I hope you enjoyed it. I'll see you next time on History, Mystery, and Murder.